What is a circuit and how does it even work? How does electricity work? All right, so the one thing that is the most helpful to understand is that electricity needs to make a loop. We have a complete loop. This is a circuit. So say we have a transformer out here on a pole somewhere. That is just a single piece of wire going through it at one end to have the start of our loop. And then say we have like a light bulb on the other end. It's another loop. So from the bottom, you know, like little part of the bulb to the screw shell, this is probably going to be connected on one side and this is going to connect on the other side. But essentially what you have on the inside is just a light filament that touches one side of that bulb and the other side of that bulb. So you have a coil of one wire. On the other end, you have a coil of one wire. And in between them, we run two wires, one to each one. That's it. That's a complete circuit. That's a loop. That's how current travels. If you break this loop and like pull it apart, current can't travel through here. There's no flow. The only way current can travel and electricity has any kind of electromotive force is if you have a complete loop. Once you connect a switch, you complete the loop, light bulb turns on. Once you flip the switch off, switch opens, no more current flow. So that is how electrical works essentially. But there's a couple of quantities that we want to think about. So when we talk about electrical terms, we're always using volts, amps, ohms, and watts. You might not use watts, you might use like volt amps if you're talking about like reactive power, you're talking about storage, like instead of energy being consumed, you're talking about energy being stored. You might talk about capacitance, like there's some other capacitive reactants and inductive reactants and things like that. You can learn about that stuff later because that's just kind of like extra details into a circuit that are not necessary to really understand electrical at a base fundamental level. So what we have is volts. Volts equals pressure. How much pressure are we putting out on the primary side of our circuit from our source? There's a generator spinning somewhere. It might be Niagara Falls, there's water falling and it's making something spin because they're utilizing that water to spin something. And that's how you get a certain amount of pressure through the system. And if you create more motion or if you change the dynamics of the magnetism inside or any of that, there's different ways in which you can get more or less pressure. You can have a smaller thing spinning or a bigger thing spinning. So you're gonna get different pressure or a different voltage from whatever is generating and spinning and making that movement possible. So over here, we've got a spinning. Let's just do like a little thing like this. Like say we have like a fan spinning. Fan spinning over here. And from that fan spinning, we're getting a pressure that is delivered to our circuit. So that's voltage. We might test 12 volts between here. We might test 125 volts. We might test 480 or 10,000 or 150,000, whole bunch of different voltages. But all we're talking about with voltage is how much pressure is there in the system. 12 volt systems with like low voltage lighting out in the grass, very, very low pressure, not very much pressure at all. And if you add too many loads on a system, you could actually drop voltage or drop pressure over the entirety of that circuit to the point where at the end of it, nothing will light up anymore because there's not enough pressure to make it through the amount of resistance that's inside of that thing. There's just too much opposition to the pressure. So nothing's gonna move. It's like a bunch of people in a crowd, right? Like you can try to get everybody to move, but at a certain point, there's like a saturation where the pressure being applied by all the people in the back and the resistance from the people on this side, like nothing's moving. And so there's no byproduct of that. There's no actual movement or flow to create anything. So that is the way that we think about voltage. Voltage is often called a difference of potential. Because on one side you have what we can think of as like a negative potential and the other side you're gonna have what's considered a positive potential. One of them is pushing while the other one is pulling at equal force and at the exact same time. So when we have that spinning going on that's in a generator back at a power plant, there's two wires that come off of that generator. And one of them, while this magnet is spinning inside of it, has a pushing motion, but at the same time, since it's spinning, while that one is pushing, the other one's pulling. So you can kind of think of this back and forth that's happening between these two wires. And with alternating current, it's alternating. It's going back and forth 60 times a second. So it kind of, it's like this fast, like vibration that's happening much faster than that. by the way. So it's almost like a constant. We almost experience it as a constant. We don't see a light bulb or load on this side blinking. But if we captured the light bulb with a camera and sat and watched and slowed everything down, you would see this light bulb is blinking. But because our eyes only, you know, like we observe reality at a certain frame rate. So to us, it actually, as fast as our brains and our eyes can process, it looks like it's just a solid thing. You can increase frequency and you can make things blink even faster. There's a lot of different, again, that's just another like angle that we could look into a basic circuit, but that's adding complexity that we don't need to really add right now. But there's a certain amount that a load is essentially blinking because it's shifting back and forth, push, pull, push, pull. Voltage is the amount of pressure that we apply. What we're actually pushing with that pressure is called current, and we say amperes are for the flow, how much flow of charge is going through this. You can kind of think of it like a whole bunch of little BBs. If we added a pressure to one side, and this is just like a tube full of BBs, all those BBs are gonna start moving. Well, each one of the BBs, how many BBs move per second, it's a rate. Amperage is the same thing. How much flow is happening per second. So a lot of current means that there's a lot of charges moving per second. Very little current, like 1 amp, is very few charges moving per second. So just remember, it's a rate at how much flow. It's like in plumbing, you might have liters per minute or liters per second. It's how much water is actually flowing through this complete loop, this complete enclosed system. So a lot of times people use water as an analogy to understand what's happening in electrical currents. And for the most part, it's a pretty accurate thing. Some of it is not 100%, but you can kind of conceptualize water in wires, sorta. So that is flow. If we wanted to take an ammeter and say we connected like a 240 volts to some wires and we had a load that over here that's like a, you know, again, like a light bulb. We could actually take an ammeter, and an ammeter is going to, or a clamp on ammeter is going to sense how strong of a magnetic pulse is happening around these conductors, because there's an expanding and collapsing magnetic field. Remember, this is a pulsing system. So it's gonna detect how much current is flowing through, because the more current, the stronger that that pulsing is going to be. It's not gonna change like how many times it's blinking. It's still blinking at a solid rate at 60 hertz or at, you know, 60 times per second in our situation, but it's going to be pulsing stronger at 60 times a second. So it's gonna detect that there's much more current flowing through, because it's just quantity of charges or quantity of BBs flowing through. So that is amperage. There's copper, and copper's made of atoms, and atoms have electrons. And when you influence an electrical field around a particle, that field can push that particle. And so the moving back and forth in an AC circuit just detects that movement. So that's amps. When you're talking about amperage, we don't send amps to stuff. We apply pressure, we connect at the other end a load, and a load has a certain amount of resistance to it. And if we don't have any resistance and we just take like another wire and connect them, a whole crap load of current's gonna flow. Current is always trying to flow at its maximum. So electrical current's always trying to like basically travel the speed of light. And it's our responsibility as electricians to try to slow electricity down so that we can actually utilize it for something useful. So a light bulb, the use that we get out of it is that we want light. So what we do is we figure out how much resistance do we need to put inside of this bulb? Like, what do we need to do to the conductor to make sure it has enough resistance so that when we hook it up to the black and the white, it doesn't explode, but instead it just starts to glow red hot or yellow hot. And now we have a wanted effect. There's a little bit of heat loss that happens. You can kind of feel that energy that's being applied is escaping in heat, but it's also escaping in light. So the escaping that's happening, the reaction from applying a resistance to a pressure or a voltage, is that it gives off something, and that something is what we call wattage. So wattage is power consumption. It's kind of a wanted effect. It's energy escaping something. So a toaster, we love wattage in a toaster, right? Because it gives off heat and we're trying to use that heat to heat up bread and toast it. So we create another kind of little wrapped up coil of wire that we call a heating element. And we hook that heating element through a cord to the black and the white. We just hook it up and we allow current to flow through. And it doesn't, like, it's not explosive, because the amount of resistance that are in those elements is so much. And you could add more elements and make it even crazy, but then there wouldn't be as much heat. There's just too much opposition. There's too much resistance. So those are our last two values. We have ohms, which is always our opposition. Again, in the crowd of people, you're applying pressure, you got a whole bunch of resistance on one side, you're not gonna get the whole thing to move. You're gonna have a stoppage that happens. So there's a certain point where you can have so much resistance in something that current can't flow through it. So if you lessen the amount of resistance, more current can start to flow. And if there's no resistance or very, very little, it's gonna flow like crazy. So controlling the resistance, everything that we hook in, every electrical device, every microwave, fridge, every vacuum cleaner that we plug in, TV, router, charging your phone, everything. We're basically just taking a certain amount of resistance and introducing it into a circuit that has pressure. And we're allowing a certain amount of current to flow. And if you maybe like hook up your phone to the wrong charger, maybe the resistance inside of that charging block is not set up for your phone. So you could allow too much current to flow through that thing and you could destroy your phone. So you start to understand, like, oh, it's all about resistance. Every load, everything that we say we're hooking a load up, a light bulb would be a load or a motor would be a load. We're hooking a certain amount of resistance to a circuit or impedance to allow current to go through it at whatever level it is designed to have current go through it. Light bulbs will blow up if you hook 240 volts to them if they're only rated for 120 volts. Somebody sat, an engineer calculated, all right, if we put a pressure of 120 volts and we take a resistance of, like, who knows, I don't know, 5 ohms or something, how much current is going to be drawn through that circuit and through that bulb, and it can handle it, or is it gonna explode? Or is it not gonna be, is it gonna be too much resistance where it's not gonna matter? The pressure is not going to allow that current to actually flow because we have too much resistance against it. That's it, that's electrical. That's the whole of everything you need to understand. Watts is what happens to the load as a result of introducing that load to a pressure. So we introduce, say, a 100 watt light bulb. Well, we know that 100 watts of power is gonna be consumed, or you can kind of think of it as like lost. There's a difference between power consumption and power loss. And in loads that are not like resistive loads that don't just have like a wire in them, you could have things called reactance, you could have things called capacitance, inductance. There's a lot of other values. Again, the deeper you get in your career where you start wanting to evaluate things on a little bit deeper level to figure out what's going on, that's when you should start looking into things like inductive reactance, capacitive reactance, and understanding how they affect things and knowing the difference between reactive power, knowing the difference between like power factor and what is wattage versus KVA, like volt amps or thousands of volt amps, because VA and wattage are very similar. They're almost like a one-to-one thing, but there's a different reason when you're talking about energy storage versus expending energy. A toaster is expending energy. A light bulb is expending energy as light and as heat. But sometimes we have storage systems, we have capacitors and things like that, that we want to maintain storage of that power. And so we look at that as VA or volt amps instead of thinking about it as wattage. So they're slightly different. But again, you don't need to know any of that. That's just crazy stuff that if you start getting like super nerdy and you just wanna watch more videos and read books, that's stuff to look into when you get to that point. But just understand the entirety of what you do every day is there's a house in between here, right? And in that house, we're putting these little loads, and outside at the street, there's a transformer, and we're just creating a whole loop through the house. Every single load that you hook up creates a loop. And when that loop is created, current is able to travel, and you have to unplug it or turn a switch off to get it to stop traveling. But each individual load that you plug in has a different amount of resistance inside of it that is going to allow current to flow differently. So some things that you plug in, only like 10 amps are gonna flow. Some things you plug in, 60 amps are gonna flow because of the amount of resistance inside of that that they want to allow current to flow through because they want this thing to have a certain amount of wattage or a reaction that is useful to us. So that's it. That's the whole shebang. Hope that helped. Share it with your teachers, share it with your classmates, share it with your buddy driving down the street. Well, not if he's the one driving. I guess if you're driving, neither one of you should be sharing things while you're driving. But I hope this helps some of y'all understand conceptually the entire system of how a circuit works and can help you in your electrical nerdom. Love you, crazy people. See you in the next one.